We're going to go to a different passage of Scripture than what you have in the bulletin today. We're going to read the Palm Sunday story. Oddly enough, Mark 11, 1 to 11. Luke does have an account of this, but we'll read Mark's version today. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing, untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches that had cut they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. There ends our reading of God's holy word this morning. Well, Palm Sunday is exciting, isn't it? I've always enjoyed this very special day in the life of the church. It's always been kind of a special feeling, has a much different feeling to it than the Sundays of Lent, which are, designed to be more somber, more reflective, time of penitence and self-examination. But Palm Sunday has a festive air, a celebrative air, leaves us usually, I think, with a happy and a good feeling. We strive to capture that in worship on Palm Sunday, typically with the songs of praise that we sing, with the strewing of the palms. We're going to have a little procession with the children later, and in other ways. Palm Sunday was, and it still is, a wonderful day. But it was a day full of paradox. And by paradox, I don't mean a couple of mallards sitting on the pond. I mean a statement or a proposition that's seemingly contradictory, perhaps even absurd, but which in reality expresses truth. The truth about Palm Sunday is that a real king was riding into Jerusalem. Let me say just a bit more about that because it is so crucial to our understanding of what's going on in this story we just read. You might remember that Jesus was called the King of the Jews. Do you remember who gave him that title? It was the proconsul of Judea, the Roman proconsul, Pontius Pilate. Let's actually look at that text a moment. It's in John 18, 33 and following. This is all the trial before Pilate, and we're just going to jump into the middle of it. Verse 33, John writes, "Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' 'Is that your own idea?' Jesus asked, 'or did others talk to you about me?' 'Am I a Jew?' Pilate replied. 'It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?' Jesus said, 'My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place.' 'You are a king then,' said Pilate." Jesus Christ reveals absolute truth. His life, his character, his words, his actions all witness to truth. Jesus embodies truth because he said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life." What that means is that Jesus will always lead you to the truth. And my friends, if you have been wrestling to know, searching to know the truth in this life, you don't have to look any farther. Jesus Christ said, "Everyone who is on the side of truth listens to me." So look to Christ, turn the control of your life over to Jesus, and you will experience and you will find the truth that sets you free. If the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. This is more than a mere intellectual assent, though, right? It has to be. For even Pontius Pilate confessed, "So you are a king." Pilate believed that enough to have the words, "Jesus Nazarenus Rex Iudaeorum," put on a board, a sign, over Jesus' head on the cross on which he was executed. Those Latin words, by the way, and you've probably seen this in churches. I don't think we have it on ours. Well, you couldn't see it anyway. Those Latin letters, the abbreviation I-N-R-I. Ever seen that on the front of a pulpit, front of a communion table, maybe on a cross, I-N-R-I? It is literally Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. That's what that stands for. But Pilate never submitted his life to Jesus as his personal king. He must have thought, okay, maybe you're the king of the Jews, but you're not going to be my king. We don't know all of what was in Pilate's mind or in Pilate's heart, but we do know what was in the mind and the hearts of Jesus' disciples. They knew the kind of king Jesus was. And I want to have us look at something Peter says in his second letter, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 to 18. 2 Peter 1, 16. "We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." We started with that song. "For he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, 'This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain." So that's the confession of the Apostle Peter. Time and time again in the New Testament, the apostles bear witness to the majesty of Christ, to the reign of Jesus Christ as the Lord of all. Another disciple, the Apostle John, John the Beloved, wrote the book of Revelation. Listen to how John begins that book. "Grace and peace to you from him who was, who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth." The images that John gives us in Revelation of this glorious king get more detailed as we get into the book of Revelation. And we can go to just one example of that in chapter 19, if you'll turn with me to that. I know we're looking at a lot of scriptures this morning, but I really want us to see these right from the Word today. Revelation 19, verses 11 to 16. "I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Wow. Do you get the picture there? When Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, "You are right in saying I'm a king," he wasn't kidding. Jesus came to this earth to lead us into all truth, to free us by his truth. And the truth of Palm Sunday is that Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is the King not only of the Jews, he is the King of all people, of all nations, and of the universe, of all that exists. One day, Scripture declares, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that he is Lord, that he's the King, to the glory of God the Father. My plea with you today is that you don't wait until the day that John describes in Revelation chapter 19, when Jesus comes on his horse with all the armies of heaven following him, to tread out the winepress and to pour out the fury of the wrath of Almighty God. Don't wait for that day to come to acknowledge him as your King. Acknowledge him as your King today. Invite him to be your Lord and your Savior today. Well, let's turn our attention to this matter of paradox with which we began the message. Where's the contradiction? Where's the absurdity in this story that we should call it a paradox? Well, it's a paradox, first of all, because it was so out of character for Jesus to accept the homage and the adulation of others. This really wasn't Jesus' style, if we want to say it that way. Jesus typically kept a low profile. He tried to stay out of the public limelight, didn't want to ask for trouble from the religious leaders. This now seems to be a different Jesus. The whole event must have seemed rather strange and out of character to the disciples, don't you suppose? And for those who followed Jesus closely, Mary Magdalene, all the other folks that followed Jesus. Might have seemed rather contradictory to just casual onlookers as well. And let me explain that. Remember that Jesus is making this journey into Jerusalem at the beginning of the Jewish feast of Passover, which, by the way, if you didn't read it in the bulletin already, begins this Friday for the Jewish community. Good Friday is the beginning of Passover for them this year. Passover, as you might recall, commemorates the deliverance of the Jewish people from their bondage in Egypt, was the celebration of their freedom and their rule from a foreign power. Now it's thousands of years later, of course, but Israel again is in bondage to a foreign power. Now it's the Romans. They're occupied in Judea by the Romans. Actually, Israel had been under the enslavement or the control of many different nations in the 500 or so years that it had been since they had had a king of their own. But the burden and the oppression of the Roman rule was probably one of the worst. It was cruel. It was ferocious. There was forced taxation, mandatory tributes to Caesar as some kind of a divine being, social and political constraints of every kind. They were basically slaves again, just like they were in Egypt, but now in their own homes. Can you imagine? The Jews were ready for a revolution, and Jesus was perhaps just the man to lead it. After all, Jesus was the greatest prophet to appear in Israel since the days of Elijah. He fed multitudes, cast out legions of demons, calmed raging seas, fed multitudes. I think I mentioned that one. Healed countless numbers of people. Just a few days before this, had raised Lazarus from the dead. There was no question that Jesus of Nazareth had the power to do what needed to be done. And the time was ripe for the coming of the promised Messiah. Maybe Jesus will be the one who can free us from this political oppression under Rome. Maybe he's the one who will restore the kingdom to Israel. What better time than Passover to stage the takeover? I mean, millions, perhaps, of pilgrims, Jewish believers from all across the Roman Empire are pouring into the holy city for this festival. And imagine their excitement here as they hear stories about what Jesus has done over the last 2.5 years. They begin to rally around Jesus because they can see that potentially he is going to take the holy city back for the Jews with some mighty demonstration of divine power, some breathtaking release of God's power. And that's why they're shouting, Hosanna, by the way, which literally means save us or save us now. That's why they're crying out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that's coming. Notice they don't say blessed is the king, but blessed is the kingdom of our father David that's coming. Luke, in his version of this story, comes right out and says that the people were thinking that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. Instantly it would be done. It would come. They're screaming with excitement in this story because they think, this is it. Jesus is going to rout the Romans today. You wonder if they weren't chanting the Hebrew version of Jesus, Jesus, he's our man. If he can't do it, nobody can. You know? A lot of excitement, a lot of expectation. Now, the very fact that Jesus was walking into Jerusalem for his Passover journey is a little bit strange, and it would have made them question. It was not customary, it was not acceptable for a Jewish pilgrim to ride an animal into the Passover festival. They were supposed to walk into the city. Those who remembered their prophecy from the days of Zechariah would remember these verses from Zechariah 9, 9 and 10. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, you daughters of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, to the foal of a donkey. And then this, verse 10, I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. Well, there it is, right in the Word of God, right in the Old Testament scriptures. By the time this day is over, the Roman chariots and the war horses will be out of Jerusalem, and the kingdom will be restored to Israel. But then we come to the point of contradiction, the point of paradox. It's one of those scenes like we have in children's activity pages where they ask at the top, what's wrong with this picture? If you've seen those. There are at least three things that are wrong with this picture. Number one is this. The first was Jesus' chosen means of transportation. Why ride a donkey? Not just a donkey, but a baby donkey, a foal. Why not ride a strong, swift steed, a stallion, you know, a war horse? Well, some historical data. In the culture of first century Palestine, the donkey, believe it or not, was a sign of nobility. It was considered royal transportation. But it symbolized humility. Obviously, a donkey kind of looks like a humble animal. And it symbolized peace. If a king was coming into another king's domain, into his territory, and he was not coming for war, but maybe just to pass through or just to bring greetings or whatever, conduct business, but he was coming in peace, he rode a donkey instead of riding a horse or coming in a chariot. What Jesus is doing here projects nothing of the image of power, of overthrow, of coup d'etat, that the pending confrontation with the Romans seemed to merit. That's the contradiction. Probably looked funny, him sitting on this baby donkey. Nancy and I used to have a miniature Sicilian burro. His name was Max, but it didn't have anything to do with Dad. I think he had that name when we got him, but I didn't sit on him very often because I was always afraid I was going to break his back, but when I would sit on Max, my feet would actually touch the ground. It was really funny, but the Jewish crowd must have thought, this is a pretty strange way for the mighty deliverer to come into town. Second thing wrong with this picture is the tears in Jesus' eyes. Luke's account of the triumphal entry says, when Jesus drew near and saw the city, he wept over it. He wept over it. Who ever heard of a crying revolutionary? There's something wrong with this picture. This just doesn't make sense. What was probably even more confusing than the tears in Jesus' eyes was what he said as the tears ran down his cheeks. O Jerusalem, he says, The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground. They will not leave one stone upon another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. Now, the Jews in the crowd that day must have thought, that's no way for a Messiah to talk. What does he mean? We don't recognize the time of God's coming. Jesus grieved. He wept then over those who did not recognize him as their Savior, as their deliverer, as their Redeemer. And Jesus grieves and weeps now over those who do not recognize and accept him as their Savior and Redeemer. Third thing wrong with this picture is what happens when Jesus enters through the city gates. This is the moment of truth, right? This is the big climax. The stage was set for this stunning power encounter between Jesus, Messiah, and all of the power of Rome. And what Jesus did in that moment was the ultimate contradiction given the hopes and the expectations of the people of the crowd. He did absolutely nothing. No miracle. No blast of divine power, no military overthrow, not even a lousy lecture to the Roman soldiers. In fact, we see in the verses immediately following the text that we read in Mark 11 that instead of hurling indictments at the Romans, he starts hurling tables and chairs and benches in the temple of the Jews, upsetting the whole Passover festival. Instead of bringing political deliverance, he brings disappointment, he brings confusion, he brings dismay and debate. The paradox of Palm Sunday is that this air of triumph and joy so quickly turns to rejection. Jubilation gives way to abandon and the scorning of Christ, because some of the people in this crowd, no doubt, are some of those same people who 5 days later will stand beside and along their religious leaders and say, "Crucify him. Crucify him. He's not my king." And yet, Scripture says they knew he came from God. No one could be doing the works that this man does unless he were from God. What a paradox. Friends, listen closely. The same thing can happen to any Christian and to any church that expects God to do what they want rather than as God intends or God plans. Jesus didn't conform to the Jews' concept of a Messiah because their concept of a Messiah was wrong. Jesus didn't satisfy their longings for a new kingdom because their longings for a kingdom were in error. They were looking for the wrong thing. They didn't understand what God was doing. And we might want to spurn those first century Jews, but we need to be careful because you know what? We share their human nature. I don't know that I wouldn't have been one of them saying, "Crucify him." How often in life don't we expect things to go the way we think they should instead of the way God has in mind? Sometimes God really surprises us. How often are we so convinced that God agrees with us? We've got to be right, right? That we're planned to do battle with anyone and everyone to make sure that our way is accomplished, because after all, it's the right way. I'm guilty of this. Any of us can be guilty of this. How often do we try to fashion a God who suits us because we think that we know the way it needs to go? Whenever we do such things, friends, we are either trying to manage God or play God, and either one is wrong. Either way is wrong. Many of us here today are old enough to remember the bombing of the Marine barracks in Beirut in 1983. 250 Americans killed in that attack, obviously many others wounded. On national television, there was a picture of the Marine Corps Commandant, Paul Kelly, leaning over a young Marine who had been blinded by the explosion and had a tracheotomy in his throat, so he couldn't see and he couldn't speak. But the general bent over to this young Marine, and the Marine reached up and touched the four stars that were on the general's four-star general. 2 days later was that young Marine's birthday, and General Kelly was informed of that, and he personally brought his rank insignia, the device that sticks on your jacket, came and brought those four stars to that young Marine and said, "Son, we are so proud of you and what you have done for our nation." The young man couldn't talk, so he motioned for a pen and a paper. And he wrote just two words, the words that are the emblem and the motto and the lifeblood of the United States Marine Corps, "Semper Fidelis," always faithful. That was his way of saying, "Sir, I was only doing my duty. I was only serving my country the way I know I was supposed to." Even in the face of death, that young man didn't lose sight of what it means to be a Marine. And in the same way, Jesus Christ, in the face of death and in the face of triumphal adulation and all of the homage and jubilation being ascribed to him on Palm Sunday, did not lose sight of what it meant for him to be the Messiah, to become our Savior on Good Friday. He didn't lose sight of his mission. Brothers and sisters, our calling is to follow God and to follow his word, not what seems good and right to us. Sometimes our circumstances can blind us to what God really wants of us. It's so easy for us in our humanness to lose sight of the kingdom when we take our eyes off the king. He's the one who defines the kingdom. It's his kingdom. When we start looking for things that we want instead of what he wants, we can get ourselves into some big trouble. But the prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane on Thursday night is the perfect prayer. It is the place of submission where we all need to be, where I need to be, you need to be. It is, "Father, not my will, but your will be done." I don't want my will in this church, and I hope you don't want your will in this church. We need God's will in this church. Jesus believed that his Father's plan for Palm Sunday and for the rest of the week ahead was his duty. And he did it. He was always faithful to the plan and the will of the Father, even to the bitter, shameful death on the cross. And that's the paradox. That is the great contradiction in Palm Sunday, that our Savior surrendered his will, his life, to God, and in the process, he redeemed us. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Father, how we praise you, thank you, that in your majesty, in your power, and in your glory, a glory that you set aside, Philippians 2 says, that you emptied yourself of your glory in order to come down to this earth to become one of us and to eventually be nailed to a cruel cross, for the purpose of accomplishing God's mighty plan to save humanity, to save us. Lord, we stand on the precipice of this Holy Week, looking at all of what you did in order to secure our salvation. And we extol you today, we magnify you, we shout, "Hosanna, blessed are you who comes in the name of the Lord." But Lord, let us look honestly at ourselves, that we not become like those who on Good Friday were ready to turn away. Lord, help us to keep our eyes on you. Help us to follow you all the way to the garden, to the upper room, to the cross, to Golgotha, and even to the Easter tomb. That's where we need to be, Lord. Washed clean, made whole, restored, sight restored, wholeness restored. Lord, bless this Holy Week for each of us. Guide us, Lord, on Tuesday night especially, as we come together as your people. Let your will be accomplished among us. Not our will, Father, but your will be done. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.